Hi students, in today's session we are going to learn how we can prevent this deadlock. So the four conditions is there, that is mutual exclusion, hold and wait, no preemption, as well as the circular wait. If four conditions apply simultaneously in the system, then there is a possibility of deadlock. Okay, if four conditions apply simultaneously in the system, then there's a possibility of deadlock. So if we eliminate any one of this condition, then there must be no deadlock. So if we eliminate this condition, then there must be no deadlock. So the first in this, in the last session, we have learned that what is meant by mutual exclusion, hold and wait, no preemption, as well as the circular wait. So the first condition is mutual exclusion. Okay, so what is meant by this mutual exclusion? The process can use only one resource at a time. So the process can use only one resource at a time. It means all the resources are non-shareable. All the resources are non-shareable. If we share among the multiple process, it will produce the error. So this is a resource. So for example, I will take this resource as a printer. If we share this printer among the multiple process, if we share this resource among the multiple process P1, P2, P3, P4, these are all the process and this will be your resource. Okay. If you share the resource among the multiple process, it will produce the wrong output. So it's not possible to eliminate mutual exclusion in deadlock prevention. So it's not possible to remove this mutual exclusion. So next concept is hold and wait. So next we are going to check whether it's possible to remove this hold and wait or not. So here the concept of hold and wait, you all know that P1, P2, the process P1 waits for the resource R2, whereas the resource R2 has been allocated to this process P2, whereas the process P2, it waits for the resource R1. But the resource R1 has been allocated to this process P1. So this is the process P1 holds the resource R1, whereas the process P1, it waits for the resource R2, whereas the process P2 holds the resource R2. Whereas the process P2, it waits for the resource R1. Okay, so how we can remove this hold and wait condition in order to prevent this deadlock? So this is one process. Only wait. So this is the first condition over here. So a process can request for the resource only when the process is holding no resource. So if there is no holding of that resource, and then in that condition it can request for resource. A process can request for the resource only when the process is holding no resource. That's it. Okay, so if this condition is there, then only it will waits for the resource. That's it. Okay, and the next condition is that suppose a process requires a file resource. Okay, suppose a process requires 5 resources in order to complete its execution. This is your process and this is your resource. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So suppose a process requires 5 resources in order to complete its execution. First, the process has to send the request. It has to send the request for all the 5 resources. Once the process has acquired 5 resources, then it has to start the beginning of execution. So once the process has acquired 5 resources, then it will start its execution. So by using this concept we can eliminate this hold and wait condition. The first condition is what? So that the process should not contain any resources. So and then the process, initially it will send the request for all the 5 resources. After getting that resource only, then it will start its execution. So in this way we can eliminate this hold and wait condition. But the disadvantages of these two condition is that poor utilization of the resources. What is meant by this poor utilization of the resources? So for example, if the process takes 1 hour for the writing operation. So if the process takes 1 hour for the writing operation, after that 1 hour only it will utilize the resource printer. Okay. So I'll explain here. This is the process, and here it will request the resource, and the resource we can take it as a printer. So after completion of the writing operation only, it will start the printing operation, right? So this printer, it will wait up to 59 minutes to print everything. So that's why we are not utilizing the efficiency of the printer in a good way. So at that time, so that another process, it will wait for that corresponding printer. So that's why this is the problem in this method, because so another process, it has to wait until the completion of the first process. So that's why we are not utilizing the efficiency of the resource in a good way. So this is one problem. So the process, it will wait for the printer. That problem we can call it as a starvation. So here in this method, the two disadvantages it will occur. That is, the first one is that the poor utilization of the resource, and the second one is starvation. What is meant by starvation? So the another process, it will waits for that resource. Another process, it will waits for that resource. That's it. So next concept is no preemption. P1 contains the resource R1. So during the execution of the process, the process cannot release the resources. After completion only, the process, it will release the resource. This problem we can call it as a no preemption. So that how we can eliminate this problem in order to avoid the deadlock condition. So I will explain here. So process PI, resource RJ, process P. So that process PI puts a request for the resource RJ, but the resource RJ, it has been allocated to PJ. Okay, it consists of two process, PI and then PJ. PI puts a request to resource RJ, but the RJ, it has been allocated to PJ. So that operating system finds that the resource is not available. So operating system finds that the resource is not available. So how we can solve this problem? So that initially that operating system finds that whether the PI holds any acquired resources or not. So if the PI holds the any resource or not, if PI holds any resources, operating system allocates that resource to PI, and then after some time it will send the request to the RJ. So initially operating system checks that whether the PI contains any resource or not. So if the for example PI holds the resource. RM means what? First, the operating system, it will allocate this resource to this process, and then afterwards, after completion of that execution, then it will send the request to RJ. Okay, by using this method, it will solve the problem, preemption problem. And the next one is that operating system forcefully releases the resource from PJ and allocates it to the next resource. This is the process PI, and this is the resource RJ, and this is the process PJ. So therefore, the process PI, it will send the request to RJ, but the RJ has been allocated to PJ. So that operating system forcefully release the resource from PJ to PI. That's it, okay? So that operating system forcefully release the resource to this PI. That's it. So in this way, it will solve the no preemption condition. So if you apply these two methods, then definitely we can solve the deadlock condition. That's it. So the next concept is circular wait. How we can eliminate this circular wait in order to avoid deadlock? So I will explain now. In order to eliminate the circular wait, operating system uses the mapping function. So what is meant by this circular wait? P1 holds the resource R1, but it is waiting for the resource R2, whereas process P2 waiting for the resource R1, but it holds R2. So this concept we can call it as a hold and wait. That's it. Okay, so how we can solve this circular wait? By using the mapping function. So mapping function means what? F is a mapping function. F represents the mapping function, whereas R represents the resource type, N represents the integer. Okay, so F represents the mapping function, R represents the resource type, and N represents the integer. So operating system uses the integer for each and every resource type. For example, the process contains the, for example, the resource type is printer is one resource, as well as the scanner is another resource. We are allocating the number for each and every resource. Printer, we will allocate it as 1. For the scanner, we will allocate it as 2. So in this way, we can solve the problem. For example, if the process is holding the resource RI, if the process, for example, I will take it as P1. If the process P1 holding the resource RI and process can request for the resource RJ. Process P1, it requests for the resource RJ if and only if the value of RJ should be greater than the value of RI. So I will explain once again. So for example, the process P1 needs 3 resources. If the process P1 needs 3 resources, that is R3, R6, and then R4. So first thing is that P1 request for R3. So all the requests should be done in an increment order. Okay, first it will request for the R3, next it will request for R4, because it is an incremental order. R3, R4, R6. If it is 5, 6, 1, then 1, 5, 6, like that. Okay. So first it will request for the resource R3, next it requests for the resource R4, and then lastly it will request for the resource R6. So function R4 is greater than mapping function of R3. Yes, next condition is that next it will request for the resource R6, right? So function of R6 is greater than mapping function of R4. So if we request the resource, if we request the resource in an increment order, then we can eliminate the circular wait. So vice versa, we can eliminate the deadlock condition also. So in this way, we can eliminate the circular wait also, and then we can avoid deadlock condition also in the operating system. That's it.